So now we come to bond cash flow structures, and we know that a bond's cash flows are in two ways. That is the principal repayment, which we're going to discuss in this slide, and coupon payments, which we're going to discuss in the next slide. Now, how the principal, that is the amount that is lent by the investor, how that is repaid is a very important consideration for the investor, because it affects the amount of credit risk that they face when they are holding these bonds. Right? Now, depending on how this principal amount is paid, affects the level of credit risk. So just keep that in mind, and we're going to discuss four structures of principal repayment that is given in detail by the curriculum, and we will see how each of these structures affect credit risk for the investor of these bonds. Right? Now, for the purpose of this reading, we've taken the principal value as 1000. The coupon rate, or the interest rate that is on these bonds, is 6% paid annually. And the time to maturity is 5 years. So the time period N is 5 years. Okay. So the first three structures, I think, are best explained in the form of this example over here that we've put over here on exhibit 4. So the bullet payment structure we've already seen. So assuming this is a 5-year bond, let's quickly look at the first example in this exhibit, the bullet bond. So at year 0, you as the investor have lent 1000 to the company that has issued the bond to you. Now you are due 6% coupon every year. So 6% of 1000 is 60. So from year 1, you get 60, year 2, you get 60, year 3, you get 60, 4, 5, you get 60. Now in the bullet payment structure, the principal amount is returned at the end of the maturity period, right? So you'll see that the 1000 that was lent is paid to you not in year 1, 2, 3 or 4, but at the end of year 5. So your principal for the first 4 years, that 1000 is still outstanding. That is, the company still owes you this 1000 till the end of the 5th year, when it makes the payment to you and redeems the bond and returns your principal to you. Right? So you will see in the 5th year, you get your final year interest 60 plus this, your principal amount, which is equal to 1060. Right? So this is a plain vanilla bond essentially, and you will see that nearly every government bond that has ever been issued will be a bullet payment structured bond. Okay, great. Now, fully amortized bonds and partially amortized bonds. Before I address these two, let me just briefly talk about amortization. Now, an amortizing bond essentially has a payment schedule that calls for a periodic payments of interest and principal. So unlike in your bullet bond, where your entire principal is paid as a bullet in one shot in the 5th year, in case of amortizing bonds, and you will see this in the fully amortized bonds and partially amortized bonds, part of the principal is also getting paid. So year 1, you will see $177, $188, $199. In a partially amortized bond, you will see $141, $150, $159. So in an amortizing bond, along with the interest, part of the principal is also retired year on year. Okay. So this is a difference between, this is what is an amortized or amortizing bond, and this is how it differs from a bullet payment structure. So this is what I have said about amortizing bonds. Do you think amortizing bonds have more or less credit risk than a bullet payment structured bond? So if your answer is it has lower credit risk, then you are right. And that is because part of the principal is getting repaid to the investor every year, unlike in the bullet payment structure where there's no principal repayment. So as the principal gets repaid year on year, the amount of credit risk outstanding or the amount of credit risk that the investor has to bear keeps reducing year on year. Right? Now, we'll quickly talk about fully amortized bonds and partially amortized bonds. Now, fully amortized bonds have, I'm just going to write this quickly, periodic fixed payments that reduce the bond's outstanding principal to zero by maturity. Right. Now, again, I'm going to explain this with the help of this fully amortized bond section, which I've just highlighted in blue. So you will see that again, in year zero, you as the investor have lent 1,000 to the company. And after that, the issuer of the bond is going to make fixed payments. So these are the fixed payments we are talking about. So it makes these fixed payments every year. And these are equal fixed payments. Right? And these fixed payments are composed of interest plus principal. Right? So this, for example, in year 1, 237 is a sum of the interest plus principal. And we've just quickly discussed how these numbers have come. So in year 1, you receive 237.4 from the issuer, right? And in year 1, your outstanding principal is 1,000, which you had initially lent, right? In the beginning of year 1, you had lent 1,000 to the issuer. Now 6% of 1,000, which is 60, which is your interest payment, right? Now, out of 237.4, and if you do basic algebra, if 237 is equal to 60 plus 177, that means 237 minus your interest payment of 60 will give you 177.4. So this 177.4 is the amount of principal that has been repaid by the issuer, right? So out of 1,000, you are repaid 177.4, which leaves you with 822.6. Now in year 2, this 822.6 is your outstanding principal amount in the beginning of year 2, and again the investor has made a payment of 237 to you in year 2. Now your coupon of 6% will not be charged on the 1,000. Why? Because out of the 1,000 in the previous year, you have already repaid the 177.4. So your coupon will be 6% of this outstanding amount, 822.6. Okay. So this 822.6 is going to be the principal amount on which your coupon at 6% is going to be charged, which is equal to 49.36. And now, out of the 237, if 49.36 is paid as interest, the balance, so 237 minus 49.36 will equal to 188.04. So this 188.04 is the amount of principal that has been repaid. Now, this 822.6 over here, this 822.6 minus, so 822.6 minus your 188.4 is 634.56. And this becomes the outstanding principal at the end of the second year. So I hope you've understood this. And you will see that this continues till the fifth year, where your interest again forms a smaller amount. And out of the 237.4, bulk of the payment has gone towards principal. And this will obviously make sense because as your outstanding principal at the end of the year is reducing, so will your 6% interest reduce as a percentage of this lower outstanding principal. So this fixed payment, as time goes by, you will see that the fixed payment is contributing more and more towards principal. So you'll see in the first year you paid only $177.4 as principal repayment, and the final year you paid $223.96. Okay, so keep this in mind, and this is an amortizing or a fully amortized bond as it reduces the bond outstanding principal to zero by the maturity date. Right? Great. Right, now partially amortized bonds. So partially amortized bonds are similar to fully amortized bonds. The only difference is that only a portion of the outstanding principal, only a portion of the outstanding principal is repaid by maturity. And again, I'll explain this with an example. So here we have your partially amortized bonds, right? Now, just ignore this $200 balloon payment at maturity. So again, you've lent the $1,000 to the investor, $1,000 to the issuer of the bond, and the issuer has decided to make fixed payments to you. So you have 201, 201, 201, 201. Just ignore this 401.92 for now. So again, you have your fixed payments for 4 years. Again, in the initial year, the first year itself, you will receive 6% of 1,000, which is $60, and 201 minus 60 is equal to 141.92. So this is the principal amount that has been repaid, and this 1,000 minus this 141.92 will be equal to 858.08, right? Now this will continue till the fourth year. Now the fourth year, your outstanding principal amount at the end of the fourth year you see is 379.17. Okay, now if then the fifth year the issuer makes a payment of only 201.92, right? So that will obviously be less than the outstanding principal at the end of the year, right? So the issuer will have to make a bigger payment than 201.92 to repay the bond by maturity. So in this case, you have something called a balloon payment. So here, there's a $200 balloon payment at maturity. So 201.92 plus 200, that is 401.92, is repaid in the fifth year, and this will comprise of your interest plus your 379.17, which was the outstanding amount, to bring this to zero. So this is known as a balloon payment because the payment is a bigger amount than the previous fixed payments, and because this is falling in the fifth year as a larger amount, this is called like a balloon or a big payment, right? So this is the difference between a fully and a partially amortized bonds. In case of a partially amortized bond, only a part of the outstanding principal is repaid by maturity, and on maturity there would be a balloon payment or a bigger payment than the previous years to settle the outstanding principal at the end of the fourth year or the previous year or the penultimate year before maturity. So this is fairly simple. I would highly recommend that you all do these workings by yourself to get an idea and understanding of how fully and partially amortized bonds repay. Right? Now, I'll just reiterate this again. Fully and partially amortized bonds offer reduced credit risk to the investor since principal repayments are made in time. So just drill this in your head. So this is a very possible question in the CFA exam. The difference between amortized bonds and a plain bullet payment structure. Great. Now, just one more thing. Fully and partially or amortizing bonds in general are particularly common in the structured finance sector, where you have something like a mortgage-backed security or an asset-backed security. Right, so just keep this in mind, and again, we will discuss mortgage-backed securities and asset-backed securities in the subsequent reading. Right, so now a sinking fund arrangement. Now, the sinking fund arrangement is another approach, like the above approaches, to achieve the same goal of periodically retiring the principal. Now, this essentially refers to the issuer's plan to set aside funds to repay the principal amount and retire the bond. So, for example, you could have a fund set aside that says, and fund set aside that pays off 5% of the principal amount each year throughout the bond's life, right? So that could be a sinking fund arrangement. So the issuer would set aside that much cash or money so that 5% of the principal is retired every year. So that is why it's called a sinking fund. Now, there can be variations of a sinking fund. Now, another variation is there in which the principal amount that is paid off, or the bonds which are redeemed, the amount increases steadily year on year, every year. So an increasing amount of the principal has to be paid using the sinking fund year on year. So this is done to retire the principal even faster than it would otherwise have been under a normal agreement, under a normal sinking fund arrangement. Right. Now, sinking funds have certain benefits, particularly for the investor. One, it reduces the credit risk, and you already must be knowing that by now, because, well, you get your principal amount periodically even before the maturity of the bond. And one, then another, it provides comfort because there is a formal repayment plan. So these are two of the biggest advantages that the sinking fund has, and at the same time it also has a couple of disadvantages. Now, in case of a sinking fund arrangement, the issuer repays the principal earlier to the investor, right? Now that the investor will receive his cash back, he might be in a disadvantageous position, in the sense he might have to reinvest that cash in another bond at a lower interest rate. And that is what we called as reinvestment risk. So reinvestment risk is the risk that the investor faces once he redeems the bonds and receives his principal. Once the issuer redeems the bonds and the investor receives the principal, and he has no option but to invest that principal again in a lower coupon bond. So this reduces his cash flows from coupons in the new bond that he has subscribed to. So keep that in mind. And there is another potential disadvantage, that the issuer, in case the bond is a callable bond, and we will discuss this later, but just hear me out. In case the bond is a callable bond, the issuer will have the option to redeem the bond at below market prices. Okay. So this could cause the investor to suffer a loss. So just keep that in mind. And we will, once we discuss callable bonds in the next video lecture, this point will become clear to you. There could be a loss since the bonds could be redeemed by the issuer at below market prices. So keep that in mind. Right? Great. Okay, now that we've done with your principal payment structures, let's come to coupon payment structures. And the curriculum has broadly given us 6 coupon payment structures. Now, coupon payment structures can be thousands of types of coupon payment structures, but broadly the more popular ones have been given to us by the curriculum. And instead of reading through pages and pages of a lot of details which might not be as useful, I've decided to break each of these coupons by their key features. What are the advantages and what are the disadvantages, so that any candidate reading this particular slide can get a holistic understanding of each of these coupons, and it will be easier for him or her to compare these coupon structures. Great. So floating rate notes, we've already discussed these in the previous video lecture. Floating rate notes are also known as variable rate notes, and unlike your plain vanilla fixed coupon bonds, floating rate notes do not have a fixed coupon bond. Instead, the coupon is linked to an external reference rate, and again we've discussed this, for example your LIBOR. And these coupon are reset at regular intervals, and in most cases these regular intervals refer to the coupon payment date. So the day the coupon payment is due is when these when this external linked reference rate is reset. Now a very important point over here: government sponsored entities issue FRN but not national government. And why is that so? Well, if you are a subscriber to a sovereign bond of the United States government, you would want a bond which has a payment which is fixed periodically. You would want your cash flows to be certain periodically. So if you're getting 6%, for example, every year, you would want that 6%. You would not want to be in a situation where your floating rate note, where 1 year you get 4%, the other year you get 7%, the next year you get 3%, depending on the change in the reference rate. So national or sovereign bonds are not issued in the form of FRNs, but government sponsored entities are. Now, you know, there's a Federal National Mortgage Association, Fannie Mae, or you have your Freddie Mac in the US. These are mortgage associations. Now, it is imperative that they are linked to the reference rate, because their cash flows, their payouts are linked to the interest rates, which have a significant effect on the value of the mortgage or the property that is being provided as an security or as an asset-backed security against the bond issue. Now again, I've said before, we'll discuss this later. Just keep this in mind that national governments do not issue FRNs, but government-sponsored entities can do. And the CFA curriculum can well put in a question where it can list out a national government and two government-sponsored entities, which will sound very much like a national government bond, and ask you which of these might or might not issue floating rate notes. So keep that in mind. And one more thing, almost all FRNs make quarterly coupon payments. So for the investor particularly, what would be the advantage of a FRN? Well, if the interest rates are expected to rise, then something like your LIBOR, which is a set of collective interest rates, will also rise. So the investor would end up getting a higher coupon, and that would be beneficial for the investor, but not very beneficial for the issuer, because he would have to shell out a higher amount of coupon, and that would reduce his cash flows. And one more thing the curriculum briefly alludes to is an inverse FRN. An inverse FRN, again, if is has an inverse relationship with interest rates. So if your interest rates rise, your floating rate coupons will actually come down. So just keep that in mind. An inverse FRN is the exact opposite of a plain FRN, where your coupon rate would increase with a decrease in interest rates and decrease with an increase in interest rates. Now, one of the problems of an FRN is continuously that it still does not address credit risk. Now, I give you the example of government-sponsored entities like Freddie Mac or Fannie Mae. And if I remember correctly, they had to be bailed out by the government because they were all the assets that they were backing had significantly deteriorated in value and none of them were generating cash flows to pay off the bondholders. And then the government had to finally bail them out by providing them a lot of liquidity to pay off the bondholders, right? So the credit risk aspect is still very prevalent in floating rate notes. Now, a small variant of these floating rate notes are your floored FRNs and your capped FRNs. Now, the word itself should tell you, a floored FRN is an FRN in which the downside, or there is a certain minimum coupon payment which will have to be paid even if the reference rate is below that coupon rate. So if say the reference rate is 3%, but there has been a floor agreed in the bond indenture of 4%, even if the external reference rate falls below 4%, the coupon payment would continue to be 4%. And this is beneficial for whom? This is definitely beneficial for the investor, because in a falling interest rate environment, say if the interest rate or the reference rate is at 3%, he would still draw, or he would still get 4% on his principal, right? And the capped FRM is the exact opposite. In case an interest rate rises, there is a certain cap, and the coupon payment by the issuer will not exceed that cap. So if the reference rate is at 6%, but if the agreement says that there's a cap of 5%, irrespective of however high the external interest rate goes, the coupon will be fixed or capped at 5%. And this will obviously benefit the issuer, because in an interest rate environment which is higher than what is agreed on, the difference between the current reference rate and the capped coupon amount will be the savings for the issuer. So just keep this in mind. It's a fairly simple concept. Yeah. Okay. Now, a step-up coupon. So a step-up coupon is essentially a coupon which can be either fixed or floating. But more importantly, it increases, the coupon rate increases by a certain margin or a certain percentage at specified dates. Now, these are typically offering protection to investors against rising interest rates, because say if the interest rates rise and your coupon is also increasing along with the interest rate at certain points in time, in that case, the investor would continue to earn interest or coupon at that higher interest rate, right? Now, there are certain advantages, like it offers protection against callable bonds, one, and there's a disadvantage that the issuer can call a callable step-up coupon bond in a declining interest rate environment. So again, we will discuss callable bonds, and once we discuss callable bonds, both this advantage and disadvantage of step-up coupons should be very clear and understandable to you. So I will come back to this once we discuss callable bonds. Now, credit-linked coupon. The credit-linked coupon is a coupon rate which changes with the change in the bond's credit rating. or by bonds credit rating, you could also say the issuer's credit rating. Now, if the issuer's credit rating goes up, the coupon on a credit linked bond goes down, and vice versa. If the issuer goes down, the investors are going to demand a higher coupon. And this is generally popular, particularly if the investor is skeptical about the quality of the company to whose bond issue the investor is subscribing to. So if there is a chance and the investor knows that the company can face issues in the near future, they can secure themselves by subscribing to a credit link coupon of that company, so that they can get a higher coupon in case the company is downgraded. And an extension of the same point is that it provides a general protection against a poor economy as credit rates decline during recessions, which makes complete sense. During a recession, typically companies end up being downgraded, and when companies get downgraded, which you've seen over here, coupon rates go up, so it provides a benefit to the investor. Now, these advantages are like a double-edged sword. Now, just keep this in mind, because assuming that there is a recession and companies' credit rates are falling, and you have a credit link coupon which increases your coupon payments, right? So if your coupon payment increases but the company's credit quality is declining, there is a very good chance that the company will not be in a position to even pay you that coupon, because it's a poor, you're in a recessionary environment, and generating cash flows to pay this coupon might be difficult, or generating cash flows to pay this excess coupon as a result of the downgrade might be difficult, and in cases can also lead to bankruptcy of these companies. So this is one of the disadvantages which I have just explained here. Increasing in coupon payment due to downgrade of the issuer will further impact cash flows and even lead to a default. So that is why a credit link coupon is like a double-edged sword. Right. Now, deferred coupon bonds, and these are also known as split coupon bonds. Just keep that in mind. Now, these are bonds that do not pay any coupon in the beginning or in the initial phase, but they end up paying a higher coupon than it normally would be. And this is generally done particularly when the issuer wants to save money or cash flows in the initial period immediately after a bond issue. So assuming that an issuer is expanding or setting up a new factory, so it will raise the money via a deferred coupon, so that in the initial years when the factory is being set up and there is no positive cash flows to pay off the bondholders, it would prefer to issue these deferred coupon bonds so as to seek relief in a way from cash outflows during the setting up of the manufacturing facility when there are no revenues or profits or cash flows being generated. Right now, in a lot of these cases, we've discussed this also, the bonds are issued at discount to par to make them attractive to the investor, because a lot of times this inability to pay in the initial stages of the post the bond issue can highlight that there is a poor credit quality of the issuer, right? And in some cases it is also advantageous, particularly to the investor, because assuming the investor is in a jurisdiction where interest income is taxable, when there is no coupon payment in the initial years, essentially the investor has saved on taxes on interest income in those years, right? So this is essentially what a deferred coupon or a step-up coupon bond is. Right. Next is PIK or payment in kind coupon. And this name is very self-explanatory. The issuer is permitted to pay the interest in the form of additional amounts of bonds or equity or some other financial asset other than cash. Right? And again, the issuer might be wanting to convert or conserve cash instead of paying it in the form of coupon to the bondholders. Now, PIK coupons are typically higher than regular coupons because investors would be worried whether the company would be able to repay the cash back at all or not. And because they are doubtful about the issue of repayment of cash and the fact that the company is paying in bonds or equity, it highlights the fact that issuers will typically consider a PIK coupon to be a higher risk investment, and hence they would demand a higher coupon. Now, from the point of view of the issuer, if the issuer is already saddled with a high amount of debt, it would typically not want to raise additional debt. So in that case, it can choose this option, assuming it is acceptable to the investors. Now, the biggest advantage from the point of view of the investor and the biggest advantage from the point of view of the issuer and the disadvantage from the point of view of the investor is that the PIK payments are at the discretion of the borrower. Now, assuming certain trigger event happens or a certain trigger event occurs, the borrower can choose whether he wants to pay in cash or in the form of other securities. Now, as the name implies, PIK coupons are payment in kind, not in cash. Great. So we come to the last type, and that is an index linked coupon. And an index linked, actually I won't say index linked coupon, is technically a wrong word, but these would be index linked bonds. Now, in an index linked bond, the coupon and the principal is linked to a specified index such as inflation. Right. Now, the most common such bond that has been issued is an inflation linked bonds, where the coupon increases by the rate of inflation in the particular economy where the bond has been issued, right? And I'm just going to spend a few minutes and discuss the various types of these index linked bonds. First one would be a zero coupon bond, then the other would be an interest linked bond, the third would be a capital indexed bond, and the fourth one would be a annuity indexed bond or indexed annuity bond. Now, I'm just going to explain this in brief on how these are essentially index linked bonds. Now, ZCBs, we've discussed before, they are issued at a discount to par value and redeemed at par value. So essentially, there is no coupon payment being made, and we've discussed this before. The coupon payment is implicit, right? So a ZCB can be inflation linked in the sense that the value at which it is issued and the value at which it is redeemed, the difference would be the factor of inflation. I hope you understood that. So the difference between the par value and the issue price would be the amount that is factored in for inflation, right? So ZCB could be an inflation linked bond. Now, an interest linked bond is simply a bond whose coupon is linked, only the coupon is linked to the particular index. Since we're talking about an inflation index, let's say that the coupon every year, the coupon increases or decreases as per the inflation in the particular economy or the particular index that is being used as a reference. Now, capital index bonds are different. Now, capital index bonds are bonds in which the interest amount is fixed. That is, the coupon rate is fixed, but the principal amount increases in line with the index during the bond's life. So if the inflation is, for example, hypothetically speaking, 2%, the principal amount would increase by 2% during the bond's life. So, yeah. Now, indexed annuity bonds, they are fully amortized bonds, and they are fully amortized because in this case, both your coupon as well as your principal is linked to the reference rate. So if the inflation is, if inflation is your reference rate or the reference index in this case, then both your principal and your coupon will increase by the factor of inflation. So roughly, we can assume or say that your interest plus your capital index bond would combined be the same as an indexed annuity bond. Okay, now this is a very rough explanation of an indexed annuity bond and whether it is a combination of interest link plus capital index bond, but this is just to help you remember during your preparation, right? Great. And with this, we come to the end of coupon and principal repayment structures. I think the last three sides which we have discussed are fairly comprehensive, and once you go through this video lecture and understand a lot of these principles, should be cemented in your mind, and this would probably require lesser reading time for you from the curriculum or the or Schweizer or any other course prep that you are following.